Welcome to the Memorial Day edition of Noir Alley. I'm your host, Eddie Muller. The film noir movement in Hollywood really picked up steam with the end of the Second World War, and a fair share of these films revolved around the home front travails of soldiers returning from that epic conflict. In today's film, Dead Reckoning, released by Columbia Pictures in 1947, Humphrey Bogart plays flinty paratrooper Rip Murdoch, who's compelled to investigate the disappearance of his jump mate, Johnny Drake, who goes on the run just before he's to receive the Congressional Medal of Honor. Rip's search leads him to Gulf City, a humid hotbed of sinister intrigue, where he encounters a local gangster named Martinelli, husky-voiced songbird Coral Chandler, played by Elizabeth Scott, and the charred body of his war buddy, cooling in a morgue drawer. The classically hard-boiled recipe is spiced up by the contempt Bogart dishes out to crooks who've gotten rich at home while he's been risking his life overseas. Martinelli, played by Morris Karnofsky, goes out of his way to insult Murdoch by boasting that his posh casino offers only the best pre-war wine and pâté. No ration stamps for the well-connected. Adding to the insult is the gangster's private arsenal having been assembled from contraband military ordnance. For Rip, the hunt for Johnny's killer becomes yet another reconnaissance mission, making it clear that even though he's back on U.S. soil, he's still behind enemy lines. Dead Reckoning, made at the height of the film noir era, serves up a full ration of noir tropes. It assembles all the requisite ingredients: fractured flashback structure, jaundiced hero on a dark quest, oily gangster with pretensions to refinement, flavorful femme fatale, sultry nocturnal setting with vinegary voiceover narration, and it coats it all with the sentimental righteousness of the loyal and lonely warrior. But I have to admit, director John Cromwell can't quite raise a souffle from this dense script, for which no fewer than five writers, including such trusty scribes as Steve Fisher and Alan Rivkin, should have earned Purple Hearts. Columbia Pictures boss Harry Cohn intended this film as a vehicle for Rita Hayworth, a sultry follow-up to the wildly popular Gilda, released the previous year. Warner Brothers owed Cohn for several star loanouts, and Cohn thought that pairing Bogart and Hayworth would breed box office magic. But Hayworth got into a fight with the studio over the terms of her contract, and she refused to make the picture. Instead, Cohn borrowed Elizabeth Scott from Hal Wallace for the part of Coral Dusty Chandler. At the time, Scott was being promoted as the threat, a direct allusion to Bogart's new wife, Lauren Bacall, to whom Scott was constantly compared, both being models turned actresses, both possessed of husky bedroom voices, and both routinely asked to sing on camera, although neither really could. His loan out to Columbia couldn't have set too well with Bogart. Here he was at the peak of his fame, but still under contract to Warners. When a star was loaned to another studio, any money the studio negotiated above the actor's normal rate, well, that was pocketed by the studio, not the actor. So this was one more chance for Jack Warner to show his most popular male star, who was top dog at Warner Brothers. There was no love lost between those two. Bogart at least had right of refusal on the director when he was loaned out, and here he got his wish for a reunion with John Cromwell, the man who had given a very young Bogart his first bit part on the Broadway stage back in 1922. By 1947, Bogart had perfected his on-screen tough guy persona. Critically, he was bulletproof. His co-star didn't fare as well. Most critics chided Liz Scott for her stilted mannerisms and awkward line readings, finding her not much of a threat at all to the silky smooth Bacall. But if you're a Liz Scott fan, and her devoted cult has grown larger over the years, you are in for a treat. She plays the role with just the right amount of ambiguity. You're never sure which side of the fence this dame is really on. Many of the exteriors were shot on location in St. Petersburg, Florida, and DP Leo Tover lights the place to give it a steamy tropical vibe, that sets Dead Reckoning apart from city-based noirs. Now, I can't say this one is on the top shelf with Bogart's other classic crime thrillers, but really, if you're trapped in an insanely convoluted plot, surrounded by duplicitous and dangerous characters, who better to steer your course through the darkness than Humphrey Bogart? And that's just what he does in today's feature from 1947, Dead Reckoning.